Welcome to the edge of the wilderness, gentlemen.
You think you know fat guys in the woods?
This is just day one.
God! Well, think again.
Whoa!
Just when you thought you OD'd on adventure,
woo, doggy,
it just keeps coming. Deleted scenes. Never before seen footage.
It's like the stupidest thing that I've ever said in my life.
Breakdowns.
I know that I can accomplish anything.
And breakthroughs.
This is me in the woods circa 2015.
Some of our greatest achievements.
Voila.
Genius.
Perfect, man.
And most embarrassing failures.
I don't even know what you would call something like that.
Buckle up, suckers.
We just dodged a almost cave-in.
You're in for a wild ride.
Oh my gosh, dude, oh my god.
This is Fat Guys in the Woods.
I don't know why I volunteer. Creek is a psycho.
Hell yeah.
Freaking A, brother.
Victory!
Since starting this Fat Guys in the Woods adventure, I have had some of the most amazing and incredible experiences of my life.
Fellas, congratulations, man.
I mean,
unfreaking believable.
The concept of the show is really simple. It's all about me taking three guys who are at a point in their life when they need a kick in the pants.
Is your motivation stronger than your pain?
Rock bottom is here, so it's time to go up.
We use a survival scenario in the wilderness to bring about positive change. Andrew, tap into whatever freaking brought you here.
It is Andrew surviving for Andrew out here.
You got it.
Our goal is to survive there for 6 days. I teach them everything they need to know about how to secure shelter, water, fire, and food for the first 4 days. And then on the fifth day, they strike off solo. You are really alone.
I mean, we will be okay, right?
They have to spend an entire day and night alone in the woods.
I ain't gonna lie, I'm scared.
When these guys walk into the wilderness, they are pushed to their absolute limits.
I think you need to be uncomfortable.
I'm very uncomfortable with that.
Good.
In survival and in life, it all starts right here. What your mind decides, your body will follow.
This is real, you know, and I did something. I finished what I started, and you know, I'm feeling great.
I was hashtag living la vida Lopez.
Man, guys, it's snowing.
This is one thing I was hoping we would avoid.
Boy, it's a soggy morning this morning, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Jeez,
man, it's cold.
The Weather Channel is the perfect home for fat guys in the woods.
Guys, it's raining, man. It's gonna start raining.
The weather is and always has been man's number one survival adversary.
Last night's rain, we ended up getting wet. So we gotta reinforce our structure.
Over the past two seasons, we've filmed in some of the most beautiful places in the country, from the unpredictable eastern woodlands to the frigid north woods of Michigan to the bone-dry deserts of Arizona and the buggy swamps of Florida. We've only seen a fraction of what Mother Nature has to offer, and it really is amazing out there.
Man, it's scorching out here in the desert, man. The sun is beating down on me.
The Arizona desert is blazing hot and already suffers from years of drought.
Man, I'm really feeling the thirst this morning, though.
Man, I'm about to die of thirst myself. It's really bad this morning.
We went for almost 48 hours with no water at all. That's very difficult to do, even in the comforts of a climate-controlled home. But you do that in the middle of the Sonoran Desert under blazing hot sun, that's the closest I've ever been to dehydration.
I ain't never been so ready to have some water in my life.
You realize how fragile we are, man.
Oh,
one day, man. We got the hurt on us.
Me and the guys aren't the only ones struggling in these extreme temperatures.
It's hot, brother.
You need anything?
No, I'm good.
Okay. No. Nope. I don't have anything.
You obviously can't teach a skill that requires sun when it's drizzling outside.
You gotta remember, we're filming a TV show here. The cameras are breaking down in these kinds of temperatures.
Can't control the weather. Can't control Mother Nature.
Yeah.
Think she cares about your cameras?
She did not give up.
The coldest I've ever been in my whole life was when I survived during the polar vortex with Matt, Ben, and Jesse.
Man, the temperature dropped.
It's bone chilling. It hits you in the face, and all of a sudden you're numb.
I can remember being in that wiki up with those guys, even with a fire, just absolutely freezing. The polar vortex was a record-breaking phenomenon. Normally, I'm not a big fan of bringing a fire inside of a primitive stick-built shelter because you're just asking for your shelter to burn down in the middle of the night. But during the polar vortex, not having a fire inside of that wiki-up was not an option.
Coldest night of my life. I'm not even kidding.
Last night was unbelievable. Brutal, brutal.
The fact that we made it through that week is an incredible feat for me and those guys.
Hey, check it out. I see a waterfall up there.
Oh, dang.
It's been pretty crappy how cold it's been, but actually we're lucky that it's been this cold to make it this. Yeah. Beautiful.
I tell you what though, man, I really want to see you throw your throwing stick at that big icicle. Man, I really want to see that thing come down.
Oh!
Nice shot.
When you're surviving in the middle of nowhere, the weather isn't the only danger.
The heck was that?
We just dodged a almost cave-in.
In fact, everything's dangerous. One wrong decision, one wrong move, one wrong step, and you could be dead.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Hey.
Oh my gosh. Wow. Seriously, death trap. The guys I take with me into the wilderness, they don't have previous survival knowledge, primitive skills, and they're typically out of shape. Injury is certainly not out of the question.
We need to jump across the rock that we're on, back onto the other rock. Wait a minute, I could really get hurt doing this.
One thing I know from experience that's gonna happen every single week is a plethora of injuries. That includes the cast, the crew.
I'm picking probably 100 cactus barbs out of my leg right now.
And sometimes even myself. And because of that, we have a medical team with us in the woods 24 hours a day, just in case.
You guys seen Johnny?
No.
He's been gone for a long time.
Why don't you guys keep on doing leaves? Let me see if I can find him.
One of the scariest moments for me was Johnny Frisbee.
Hey, Johnny, that you? You all right, man? We've been wondering where the heck you've been.
I don't know. I'm just not feeling well. Real dizzy.
Blood pressure's a little high, brother.
After the medic checked him out, he had an erratic heartbeat. And so it was really important to get that guy out of the woods and into a hospital.
It's freaking nuts.
Anytime you venture into the wilderness, you are never alone.
Dang, listen to those coyotes.
The woods or desert or swamp is full of animals.
This right here is how they defend themselves, you know?
I'm totally over this. I don't know why I volunteer. Creek is a psycho. Something's wrong with him.
By far, one of the most dangerous animal encounters that we had was when we trapped that wild boar down in that huge rock pit.
I'm gonna go up and try to get it to charge or try to flank it. If it comes down toward you, you gotta block it with this thing. You know, just don't let him at your legs, man.
You ready?
Yeah.
Can't believe I'm doing this.
Wrestling that boar to the ground was a long process. I mean, that took us 45 minutes to an hour, and it looked like it only took like 5 minutes on camera, if that.
God, get in, Parker.
Okay, just breathe.
One thing that was kind of crazy in that scenario is once we got it down and got up on top of it, Johnny was exhausted. We were all exhausted. And I can just remember looking over my shoulder and seeing Johnny raise up with that big knife.
Be careful, because our legs are freaking here.
Thinking, if he misses and comes down into my leg, I mean, I could literally lose my leg. By far, the most dangerous challenge we've done on Fat Guys in the Woods is in season 2 when we rappelled off a 200-foot cliff.
Woo, doggy.
Go ahead and sit back. Just sit back. You're too vertical. Lean back into it. Post your feet up on the wall. I'm just thinking the whole time, man, I hope I tied all the knots right.
You're about to go free falling here pretty soon.
I'm already doing it.
Sounds like he just smacked the wall with his face.
Not only did the three guys and myself go over that cliff, but we had camera guys dangling off of the edge of that cliff.
Right now, we got a camera guy stuck up on a rope.
The tether to his camera got hung up, and he couldn't go up, he couldn't go down.
Oh!
And it was just a crazy moment.
Everyone get out from underneath me!
That guy's dead.
Gary Johnson.
Hey-oh!
If I lost it.
That was scary.
You want to head down in there with me?
I don't want to, but I will.
On Fat Guys in the Woods, three guys get off the couch.
I ain't had no recliner. I ain't had no TV. And I'm still living.
And into the weather.
It hits you in the face, and all of a sudden you're numb. It's bone chilling.
Sometimes they're friends.
Martin, this way straight. To your left.
How do you know that's straight, Kyle?
Because it's to the right.
Oh, sometimes gosh. Strangers.
You honestly expect us to believe that your last name is Frisbee.
Yep.
But they all have one thing in common. Me. Ponytail and all.
Look at the ponytail on that man.
Creek looks like he should be on a surfboard in California, not tromping through the woods.
He's the Fabio of the caves and the woods.
Look at his gloves. Watch are almost up. As yellow as his vibrant hair.
As soon as you see Creek, you're like, this guy probably like has deep conversations with trees.
Just want to make out with this tree right now. Follow me.
He's like the survivalist Moses.
When Fat Guys in the Woods came calling, I was ready because, as luck would have it, I've been preparing for this show my entire life.
I grew up in Boy Scouts, and I fell in love with the outdoors at a young age. I taught my first course when I was 21 years old on my parents' farm, and I taught courses part-time while I worked side jobs to make ends meet. And almost 18 years later, I run a full-fledged survival training facility in central Indiana called Willow Haven Outdoor. One random Tuesday, I got a phone call from a producer out of Los Angeles named Evan Goldstein, and he talked to me about this concept he had for this survival show, Fat Guys in the Woods. And the more he talked about it, the more I liked the idea. The cameras and crew are there to capture our experience in the woods.
Everything about this area is trying to suck the life out of our fire.
But there really comes a point when you get so involved in trying to meet basic human survival needs. Quite frankly, we just forget the cameras are there.
Oh my gosh, dude, oh my gosh. Freaking Carl, you punk. Sounded like a freaking snake at my feet. I'm all jumpy with this snake.
Doing interviews throughout the week is a big part of the show, telling the audience how we're feeling, what we're experiencing. There are so many interviews, especially for me, week after week after week. Sometimes I get a little loopy.
Oh man, that's the best no call I've ever had.
Sometimes I get ridiculous.
This is exactly what primitives in this area would have used for their weaves.
Sometimes I get angry, blah, blah, blah. Somebody write me a freaking script or something. I'm human, and I go through all of those emotions in those interviews.
And one perfectly preserved blonde ponytail. It's like the stupidest thing that I've ever said in my life.
Survival priorities, whether it's in a real life survival scenario or for us on the show, are always the same.
We're gonna use everything we've got to meet our core basic human survival needs. Shelter, water, fire, and food.
You'll notice that I structure our entire week around those core four survival priorities.
You don't think we can get a couple steaks on there?
What have I told you, Martin, about our survival priorities, man?
I'm not getting them straight, am I?
No.
Just on the constant lookout for a good shelter spot.
Shelter is almost always our first survival priority, and that's because in extreme conditions, you can only survive for 3 hours without shelter.
That's gonna be bigger than my house.
Well, once you jam four guys into it, it's not gonna feel very big.
And so many people don't realize how labor and calorie intensive building a primitive shelter is.
Man, this is exhausting. I didn't think gathering leaves would be so much tough work.
The audience sees a shelter go up sometimes in a minute, and that shelter can take up to 6 hours of hard work.
It's my cardio for the year.
Day one is literally trial by shelter.
You gotta admit, that's comfortable.
Nice.
Over the course of 2 seasons, we've built 16 very unique group shelters. It's a challenge for me to think of another new creative shelter that can fit four guys safely and securely for 6 days.
There is something kind of spirit of the wild about how that all worked out. You look at it and you're just like, I can't believe we three knuckleheads in Creek did that.
I mean, dude, it's huge inside.
My absolute favorite shelter has got to be the Swamp Nest Treehouse in the Dead Lake Swamp.
This is a cool looking spot. Got this big old tree.
Are we gonna sleep in the tree?
I'm kind of feeling a treehouse, actually.
Every boy's childhood dream is to sleep in a treehouse, and we got to do that in real life in the middle of a swamp, and it was awesome.
1,000 pounds up here.
Dude, there's so much weight in this shelter right now, man.
Yeah, it's not even creaking or popping or anything.
People say you can do anything with duct tape, and we proved it in the Dead Lakes. We assembled almost our entire shelter with duct tape and sticks.
You know that old saying, if you can't duck it, chuck it, or something like that.
Time to test these bad boys out and make sure we're gonna make it through the night.
Oh,
you got it.
Who's going crashing to the ground first?
Oh no, don't, dude. I don't know, you're so tall, man. You got it, buddy, good job.
If you start hearing excessive cracking going on.
There you go, guys. I'll you some TV.
That's all right.
Sorry, we'll man.
One shelter you're going to see in every single survival book is the debris hut. The debris hut that I made with Stone, Johnny, and Nick in the Great Smoky Mountains was so airtight, nothing was getting in or out. Here's something that no one knows. You saw that we found and gathered and ate Jerusalem artichokes.
Jerusalem artichokes for dinner. And Jerusalem artichokes for breakfast.
But a lot of people don't know that Jerusalem artichokes are notorious for giving people bad gas. That debris hut smelled like we were sleeping in a porta potty on a construction site.
Stomach is in knots right now.
If someone would have lit a match, that thing would have gone up like an H-bomb.
Welcome to the edge of the wilderness, gentlemen.
On Fat Guys in the Woods, I take three guys into the wild to learn how to survive with next to nothing.
That's it, really?
In this double XL edition, you're getting a glimpse of what it's really like, from extreme temps,
coldest night of my life,
to dangerous heights.
Woo, doggy.
And even with the coolest shelter around,
it's like a spring mattress.
You won't have a chance if you can't make fire.
Fire in a survival scenario is related to everything. You use it to stay warm, to regulate core body temperature. You can use it to signal for rescue, boil and purify water, cook food, keep insects and predators at bay. But starting fire survival style without modern tools like matches and lighters is a lot easier said than done.
Dan is rough.
The hardest ways to start a fire in the woods are friction fires, rubbing two sticks together to make fire, the way cavemen did it.
First thing, put down your ember catch so that your ember doesn't hit the cold ground. The hearthboard with the notch goes right on top of the catch. Left foot on your hearthboard. You gotta stabilize that. You wrap your spindle on the outside of the string. Fat end down, pointy end up. You want more friction on the bottom and less friction at top. Take your bearing block, put it on top in your left hand. Pinch your wrist up against your shin. If you try to muscle it, I promise you, you'll fail. Just feel it spin to start with. See how I'm getting a little bit of smoke? I'm going a little bit faster. I'm filling my notch with dust. Once that notch is full with dust, I pour it on. Stop nice and easy. See how that's smoking on its own?
You made that look so easy.
And that, guys, is how you make an ember with bow drill.
All friction fires are difficult, but the Mount Everest of friction fires is the hand drill.
Doesn't get any more difficult than taking your hands and rubbing two sticks together to create an ember and then blowing the flame.
My hands hurt already.
Yeah. Get ready to get blisters, suckers.
I remember when Dave, Bill, and Andrew were trying to make fire using that hand drill. It was damp. The conditions were horrible for the hand drill.
Guys, if we don't get this tonight, our only other option is spooning.
Good. Beautiful.
Those guys buckled down, they fought through the pain, and they manned up in the middle of the damp Tennessee woods to get a hand drill friction fire. And that was the first for all three of them.
We have fire, man.
Aside from primitive friction fires, I love all different types of fire starts.
Are you really about to do this with a flashlight?
You never know what resources you're gonna have available in a survival scenario.
Next thing I know, the man's pulling out a sleeve of condoms. Wait a minute.
I knew we'd come to the wrong place.
I didn't sign up for that.
Frisbee goes, I knew we'd come to the wrong place. It's funny to me even today.
Tampons.
What? The craziest fire start I think I've ever done and seen in my life is the tampon fire cigar.
Wait, hold on.
Who's putting their mouth
cigars
on
go in your mouth. That's exactly right.
We're gonna take some of our ash, we're gonna sprinkle it, and we're going to roll it up.
Tampon sushi roll.
That fire start originated from a series of experimentations that I did back at Willow Haven. I rubbed some charcoal on the tampon to try to darken it up to absorb heat from the sun. And one thing led to another. I was rubbing the tampon, it was getting hot, and I realized that the combination between cotton and charcoal had the potential with enough heat and friction to create an ember.
There we go.
All right.
Man, I'm gonna go let it go.
Good job, man.
All right. There's one thing I hate about fire, and that is when smoke just keeps blasting you in the face no matter where you move.
Literally, and sitting in a chimney.
And I swear smoke follows me, man. Everybody says the same thing, it follows them, but it seems like every time I stand next to the fire,
jeez,
I'm getting blasted in the face with smoke.
I'm sorry, guys, but I can't even talk through the smoke.
We have to build a sleeping platform. That's awful, man. I mean, I'm sorry.
I'm trying.
Be a good day, Tate.
In this episode of Fat Guys in the Woods,
we have fire, man.
We're giving you a glimpse of how three not so slim fellas,
we look like sumo wrestlers in a Honda,
and one rough and tough crew,
day 17 in the desert. Yikes.
Fight to survive in the middle of nowhere.
We are truly cut off from civilization this week.
A next to impossible feat without one of our top priorities.
We need to strike out for water.
H2O. After we secure shelter and fire on the show, our next survival priority is water.
Check that out.
Nice water.
It's so important to secure a stable water source that we can tap into all week long.
It was so good. That was the best tasting water I ever tasted in my life.
We always take for granted that luxury, turning on a tap, going to the fridge, grabbing a bottle of water. But you see how hard these people had to work out here just to get a steady water source.
Over the past two seasons of Fat Guys in the Woods, I've taught the guys how to find survival water in some of the most unpredictable places.
See those vines right there? It's called grapevine. These suckers are full of fresh drinking water.
Oh, wow.
That's a little hard to watch, man, I'll be honest with you.
There's plenty of water frozen around us. We're just gonna scoop snow into our canteens and melt it down.
I know there's yellow snow. I left some out here. I don't wanna put that in there. It might be European snow.
Oh, dude, that's what we're looking for, man. Back in the day, for fresh water, pioneers would develop what's called a springhead, man, where the water comes right out of the mountain. There's enough water coming out, man. I think it should flush your hole out pretty quick.
You want us to drink this dirty water?
Open water sources like ponds, rivers, streams, and puddles are very dangerous. Even though they may look clear, it's deceiving because they can be infested with waterborne pathogens like viruses, protozoan cysts, and bacteria. They have to be purified.
Tastes like someone lets one go when you're sitting around with your mouth open.
What happened to all the water? This is unbelievable. There was water here yesterday. I am dying of thirst.
When we lose water, our blood thickens, our heart works harder. You can't get the blood to the extremities. The brain doesn't function properly. Everything begins to shut down without water. It is a critical survival priority.
I am so, so thirsty right now.
When we were dehydrated in Mendoza Canyon in Arizona, we finally found a stable water source on day two, but it was far from perfect.
Here's what we're looking for right here.
Water. That's not water.
Oh, yes, it is too, man.
I was hoping to find a beautiful mountain spring, and we found a sludge pit.
This is our water source right here for the whole week.
It was filled with insect larvae, algae, floating debris. We had to not only pre-filter it to filter out all that gunk, but then we had to
purify it using our water purification tablets. This was a process that took several hours and was a huge test of our patience.
I think I'm gonna lose my mind if we don't get this water in my system soon, and very soon.
One cool water skill that you didn't see that fell to the cutting room floor in the edit room was when Stone, Nick, and I made condom canteens to gather up water.
We should really try to take as much water back with us as possible, yeah. You know?
I'm thinking this might be another opportunity to use those condoms.
All right, milkman, fill this baby up.
There we go.
Now we need to protect this thing.
I showed them how to fill a condom in their sock and top it off with an elderberry spout. And that thing held like a liter of drinking water.
Voila!
Genius!
There's one thing about drinking water. It makes you pee. But when you don't drink a lot of water, your pee gets really concentrated. And I'll never forget the night when DJ, who was laying right next to me, decided to roll over, pull his pants down, and pee right through the floor of the treehouse shelter.
I didn't go to the bathroom. I don't want to get out of here. I'm cold.
Creek.
What?
Scoot over just a little bit.
No.
What is
dude.
He doing?
What are you doing?
Oh, are you kidding me?
You know it's bad when you can smell how dehydrated the guy is next to you.
I cannot believe you just did that.
Oh my God.
I just peed next to the
After we secure shelter, water, and fire, it's time to start thinking about food.
Creek, we're gonna have to do something about food today.
Yeah, I'm hungry, but he's hungry. He's no fun.
And even though humans can survive for 3 weeks without food, most people in modern society start feeling the effects of not eating within 24 hours.
I'm freaking starving.
We're all starving, yeah.
What are we gonna do?
I hear you. I'm hungry too.
Even though I'm really hungry and frustrated, I'm trying to hide my frustration with the food situation.
I never had to experience hunger pains like this before. I mean, all of us has been hungry before, but this right here is on a different level.
I want something to eat. I'm dying. I'm hungry.
The only thing I want is food, so at this point, I'm willing to do whatever it takes to eat.
At some point, we have got to replenish the calories that we're spending, and over the course of 2 seasons, we've proven that nothing is off the menu in the wilderness.
Bingo. What the hell is that?
Grubs, like beetle grubs.
So this is Creek's interpretation of breakfast, a worm out of a rotting piece of wood.
Don't think about it, swallow it. Swallow it.
Go.
Hey, good old nut. It tastes like meth inside of a nut.
These wood lice are our first meal of the week.
You gagging, dude? When you're at home.
I'm a visual eater, so to see that gruel looks like baby poop.
There is nothing about this tarantula in any stage of the preparation and cooking process that makes it look like food.
Phew, it stinks.
Sometimes I just can't let the crew off the hook, you know? They sit there the whole time and watch us eat all this crazy, disgusting stuff. But with that tarantula, I wasn't gonna let it pass.
Hey, Evan, there's still leftovers.
Eat the chest. Suck it up, Mr. Producer.
Swallow it. This tastes raw.
Evan just had the chest cavity of a tarantula, man.
The grossest meal I've had in the last 2 seasons of Fat Guys, actually in my whole life, has been that scorpion in the Sonoran Desert.
What does it taste like, man?
It is so nasty.
Dude, you just ate the head.
Oh, God.
Dude, come on. Just swallow it, man.
Try it, Creek.
It was absolutely disgusting.
Oh man, I'm not even, what is that flavor?
I don't know, man.
It tastes like somebody vomited, you shaped that vomit into a scorpion shape and grilled it over a fire and then re-ate it.
It tasted like Satan farted in my mouth.
I hope I never in my life have to eat scorpion again.
That was nasty.
There's a lot of dirty work when putting meat on the table. Most people don't see all of the steps that lead up to eating meat. And the killing process, the hunting process, is a very emotional part of our week.
I've hunted, and it makes it a little different when the thing is still alive.
Ah, it's never pretty. Thank you, bird.
I had to basically be its executioner.
You all right, man?
Yeah, it's just sad.
One clean sweep with that knife. It's a heck of a thing, brother.
You know, I came out here to be able to make sure that if the day ever came that I had to do this, that I could do it.
There it is. It's over, dude.
Yeah.
It's just it's done. Like that. Dave?
Yeah.
All right, man?
Yeah, it was crazy. Every emotion and thought I could probably have rushed through my head in a 30-second window.
For some of the guys, this is the first time in their life that they've killed their own food. I totally understand when they get emotional in that process. A lot of survival food is a mental game. If you can get past that mental barrier, then sometimes the food, even though it looks crazy, isn't that bad.
That's the best pair of legs I've seen this week.
Oh, gosh. Oh, gosh.
You took that first bite of squirrel, and it reminded me so much of childhood when my Aunt May would do it. And I'm sorry, Aunt May, but I think that squirrel was better.
Tastes like a pork chop. I'm enjoying a turtle that I killed, totally freaking me out.
I'm gonna save this other eyeball for you.
So you have to suck the eyeball out?
Well, there's four eyes.
Yeah.
Four eyes, four guys.
Possum. Heaven in my mouth.
You like that skin, don't you?
Uh-huh.
Like pork skin, doesn't it?
Mm.
The texture of it is beefy, but the taste of it, chicken.
On Fat Guys in the Woods,
we have entered the bone zone.
You see me show the guys how to secure shelter, water, fire, and food.
Yeah. We could eat that puppy
Dude,
alone.
That's a trout, man.
But then there finally comes a time when they have to do it all on their own.
Yay.
Solo day.
A big part of the Fat Guys in the Woods experience is solo day. You've got to build a shelter on your own, make a fire on your own, and spend the night tonight in this woods alone. This is a great opportunity for the guys not only to test their skills, but to reflect on life back at home.
I've got to do something to change my life. And if I don't, I don't want to be a big fat blind guy. I really don't.
You know, those are some of the best scenes of the show, I think.
Yeah. You know how manly it feels when you go to the copying machine and you're like making printouts? No, camping in the woods alone in a tent you built out of twigs. Ha!
That's how you feel manly. Even after two seasons, these guys never cease to amaze me on solo day. Holy mackerel. Is this a survival shelter or a vacation timeshare, man? Oh my gosh, this is awesome. You know, it reminds me of when I just got started in survival, you know, when I used to do all kinds of different things and I didn't have my old standby routine. And I love watching these guys come up with new, creative, fresh, and innovative ways of making it through a night in the woods.
I like it, man. It's different. You're like the Michelangelo of shelters, man.
Frustration is just a part of survival.
I'm having a lot of trouble. Frustrated. Pissed off. This is gonna be a crappy, crappy night.
The key is not letting your frustration get the best of you.
Oh, wait a second. Oh, I did this wrong.
I freaking freeze tonight.
Creek, where are you right now?
There were definitely some instances where I had to step in and save the day.
We need to do a little bit of work on it.
A little bit is an understatement.
You can't go out right now.
Nope, nope, nope.
Caleb, I love you, buddy, but I hate to even use the word shelter when it comes to your solo base camp, man.
Boy, you got an interesting looking camp. Is recliner style or what?
Yeah, man.
This is definitely one of the most unique shelters I have ever seen.
I don't even know what you would call something like that. And to top it off, I had to help you build your fire, man.
Just keep there. There you go.
Hey, brother.
Hmm?
You got fire?
I got fire.
Solo day is one thing, but solo night is an entirely different animal altogether.
I got my knife. I'm good.
For some, it can be really profound.
I know that I can accomplish anything.
It's amazing.
What the f***?
You hear a twig snap and you're like, what's that?
For others, it can be absolutely terrifying.
I mean, I'm embarrassed to say this, but I'm a grown-ass man, but I am afraid of the dark.
Okay, I don't know how I'm gonna make it tonight. I mean, really? I mean, ain't nobody got time for this. What am I doing? What the hell have I got myself into? This is my time to be a big boy. There's no way I can go to sleep tonight. I'm staying my ass up tonight. I'm staying up tonight. No, I'm not going to sleep. I can't do it.
As soon as the guys wake up on day number 6 after solo night, all of them are only thinking about going home.
I'm definitely happy to be able to have a chance to get out of these clothes and take a nice shower and get home.
But before we walk out of that woods, there's still one thing to do. I want to give you the same exact knife rig.
Shut up.
That I use myself.
Thanks, man.
To remind you that you've already beat the odds. You earned this week, man. You are definitely sufficient.
That is a thing of beauty, gentlemen.
That's awesome.
What?
Dude, that is cool.
This is so cool, man.
Congratulations on a job well done this week, man.
That's awesome.
This right here is the Fat Guys in the Woods equivalent of receiving an Academy Award. The reason I give this knife is because it's a symbol of their experience in the woods, you know, and the symbolism is different for every guy.
That's incredible.
You know, maybe this represents overcoming an obstacle with food. Maybe this represents connecting with their past or their future.
Jim, I actually would like for you to give this knife to your granddaughter.
Oh, awesome.
It's a lifetime reminder of overcoming obstacles.
I worked my tail off.
Good job this week. Pushing through hurdles and doing things that are incredible.
It will always, always signify one of my personal greatest achievements that I've ever done in my life.
One thing a lot of people don't know about the show is how emotional I get at the knife ceremony.
There's one more thing in the bottom of that pit.
Not supposed to make me cry, you redneck. Somebody say something funny.
God love the editors for helping me out in editing out all my crying when I give this knife to the guys.
The true test of a survivor.
You gotta remember, I spend a week with these guys. You get to see them for 42 minutes.
It's like some tissues now. I got a tampon.
I really learn about their stories and their lives back at home and how much this experience means to them.
See, I'm such a freaking crybaby, it's ridiculous.
And believe me, it's almost embarrassing because every time a knife ceremony rolls around, it's like somebody flips on the switch for the waterworks.
You made me cry, Creek, man. You gotta cut this out, man. Just get to it, man.
Why are you doing this? I'm trying to freaking talk. Over the course of 2 seasons of Fat Guys in the Woods, I've met 48 of the most incredible guys that I could ever spend a week in the woods with. I hope you're ready for a crazy week.
Super excited, man.
We've had some really memorable characters on the show, and some of them are just impossible to forget.
There's no way this guy's alive. I've stabbed him like 5 times.
It's a catfish gangster.
Top of the fact that we had the honey like a little dipping sauce, and you dip your little whoopie wham into the sauce. Oh my goodness. Be surprised is what I call it. It was delicious. It really was.
I did not climb my way to the top of the food chain to drink this for dinner. I'm going to tell you right now.
The layers may have been a bad idea.
The fat guys have already been making some really positive changes in their life.
I'm an IT guy by day, which means I sit on my butt an awful lot. Coming out here was a reminder of who I once was, but, you know, helps me gain more appreciation for what I have today and who I am today.
Hey guys, it's Dave from season 1 of Fat Guys in the Woods. Wanted to take a minute to update you on how I've been doing. I've been teaching classes. I've joined a community emergency response, otherwise known as CERT team. I can't say thank you enough to Creek, everybody else, for just getting my ass off the couch and into the woods. It's been amazing.
Terrence's mother passed away as a result of a car accident, and he hasn't been back to visit her grave since the funeral.
It's your boy Terrence Boykin here, straight from Dothan, Alabama. And because of Fat Guys in the Woods, I got the courage and the strength to come here. I'm actually at my mom's grave right now, y'all. I'm just happy to be back here and get some closure, you know what I'm saying?
Creek said, you can go 3 weeks without food,
And when he said that, it kind of clicked in, like, I might be hungry, but I'm not gonna die, man. You got 3 weeks.
Since participating in Fat Guys in the Woods, as you can see, I slimmed down a little bit. A player lost about 50 pounds trying to live, and trying to stay alive, you know, the spirit of the forest.
I'm okay. So I'm an Eagle Scout who has not been in the woods forever. I've lost a connection with the outdoors and instead found a connection with the internet and donuts, which have not helped me with my weight.
This is me in the woods circa 2014. This is me in the woods circa 2015. That's 278 pounds of flab and ice cream and donuts. This is 208 pounds of muscle, energy, and charisma.
Figure out how you can get outside and do more stuff. It's a fun way to stay fit and healthy and sexy like me. I don't actually know where I am.
We have had so much feedback from the audience and from fans of the show.
Everyone in our family is a huge fan.
I've learned something new from every episode.
At the end of the week, when these guys come out, they can be confident that they can survive.
After watching a season of Fat Guys in the Woods, I'm not limited. I can do anything a skinny guy can do.
We receive so many questions from fans about the show, and here's your opportunity to get answers. Even though we spend most of our time trying to stay alive, building shelter and fire and finding water and food, we do have a little bit of downtime occasionally to let off some steam. And I tell you what, there's nothing like having a little bit of fun to boost morale.
I'm Peter Tarabarelli for News 11, live here in the Sonoran Desert.
Have you ever peed on your belly?
Never.
Have you ever,
like, not
peed on your belly? I'm like this. Like,
now, Gingerbeard, what do you think you're going to have for your first meal?
Tacos, just tacos.
Oh man, that fire feels so good.
Sure does.
Jeez. He did not just do that.
I know for me, I might just devour an entire stromboli all by myself. Reporting to you live here in the Sonoran Desert, I'm Peter Tarabarelli, News 11.
From that wasteland cowl I wore in the desert to the coonskin cap of the forest and even the Thunderbird vest in the swamps, people always ask me, do I pick out the clothing that I wear on Fat Guys in the Woods? And the answer is yes, I do.
No one picks out my wardrobe. These are just clothing items and pieces that have worked for me over the years.
One of the main reasons why I became a survival instructor in the first place is because I love the outdoors. And so one thing that you don't get to see on Fat Guys in the Woods is the efforts we make after we wrap the show to make sure that we leave every location we visit as good, if not better, than when we got there to begin with. So we always put out our fires, and in this instance, we're taking a lot of trash home with us. I hate seeing trash in the woods.
Fat Guys in the Woods is a crazy idea, and it's been one of my life's biggest adventures. But I tell you what, I won't be satisfied until every man, woman, and child can be dropped off in the middle of the wilderness with absolutely nothing and provide themselves with shelter, water, fire, and food.
All right, guys, it's a wrap on season 2 of Fat Guys in the Woods.
That's a much-needed cake right now, man. So remember, survival is simple. Just don't die.
I'm gonna pound town this whole thing.
Awesome, dude.